Hello, and it's very nice to be here to talk with you all about WEMWBS and find out how you're using it. I'm going to be talking about the development and validation of WEMWBS to start with, and it's important to realise this is very much a collaborative venture. I've been working with lots of other people, one of whom is sitting here today, Steve Platt. Jane Parkinson's also in the audience, but this is just some of the people who've been contributed to what we're going to talk about today. So my plan for the next 20 minutes or so was to do a little bit about why we developed this scale, what was the thinking behind it, some of which may be familiar to you. Then go on and look a little bit about how we validated it and what we did, and then finally look at how is some overview of how it's currently being used. Does that feel like it meets the foots the bill? Good. Okay. So if you would just follow me, we shall start. Why? If we think about mental well-being or mental health at a population level, it could theoretically look something like this if we were going to plot it quantitatively, with the number of people here and the level of mental health along here, from poor mental health at this end to good mental health at that end, with most people somewhere in the middle and a few at each end. I know there is quite a lot of discussion about whether mental health is actually a dual continuum, one spectrum or two, one dimension or two, and indeed possibly many more. But for the moment, we're going to leave that on one side and simplify things. This will do however many dimensions there are. In the past, public health practitioners, health promotion people, policy makers, doctors, Uncle Tom Cobley and all, have been extremely interested in what's going on down this end of the spectrum. And they've kind of drawn a nice little cut-off and thought that really what went on above that was, if you were over that bar, fine, no probs, don't need to think about you. So there has been very little thinking until very recently about this end of the spectrum, about mental well-being and what that means and what might determine it. There have been a couple of perfectly wonderful studies, one called the Timberlawn study that John Cleese talks about in his books, Families and How to Survive Them, and another called the Nun study, where they did some research on women going into convents and then looked at their longevity, which show that mental well-being is profoundly important for all aspects of your health. But they're just, a couple of little studies that have been done, and we don't really think about them too much. We need to think about this end of the spectrum, but we also need to think about this middle bit. This represents a huge amount of misery here. People who find it very hard to make relationships with other people, who create distress and distress themselves, who get stressed and use alcohol, drugs, or food, or various other ways to sort out that stress. The other thing is that this, obviously, you're not born at one point and stay there. We go up and down this a bit in our lives, and people who are here who have a major life event, as happens to a great many of us, will pop into here for a while. So, the whole thing is slightly dynamic. So we do need to be very interested in this part of the spectrum and this part of the spectrum. I was going to say one other thing about this point. Most of the instruments that have measure mental well-being at a population level have been developed with this sort of thinking in mind. So they are interested in this bit of the spectrum. They're very good at picking up people who are mentally ill. That's what they're designed to do. But they kind of stop here. That's the maximum score you can get on most of these measures. So if you're trying to help people who are here get up to here, you can't do it with those measures because they've already scored 100%. So that's what we call a ceiling effect of an instrument, and that was true of many of the measures that were around when we started thinking about this. So just to summarise we need to think about mental well-being so we can look at what determines, what makes people really mentally well. We need to develop the capacity to improve mental well-being, so to move people up the spectrum from they're fine, they're not of interest to psychiatrists, but they're really not functioning at their optimum. And we also badly need measures that can help us measure whether anything we do at a population level or at an individual level helps people move from being okay to being well. But I think there are also another couple of very important reasons why it is important to do this. The general population, both in this country but also in England, and it's creeping into our policy documents, are absolutely clear it's time the NHS thought about well-being as well as disease. They want us to think about and develop policies and approaches to promoting well-being and not just sorting out people with disease. And we are increasingly driven, and should be, by what the general public want. So this is going to come on stream more and more. Of course, in the local authorities, well-being has been more of on the agenda for a longer time. It tends in that context to be more about physical activity and the environment and things that food, things that local authorities have traditionally been interested in. But they're equally taking on board some of this work about mental well-being. But there is another more fundamental reason, and this it comes partly, well, I've discovered it, in some of you may know I spent a lot of my life working on parenting and parenting programs and how you can improve parenting and then children's well-being as a result of that. And there is a wonderful adage in the parenting programs, which every parent learns, it's what you pay attention to is what you get more of. And that works with behaviour management very well, because children crave attention so much that if you only notice them when they're doing something you don't like, they will do more of what you don't like. That sets up a vicious cycle and things get worse and worse. But the adage is true across all different walks of life and in all different areas of life. And we spend our lives worrying about mental illness and focusing on mental illness and thinking about ways of dealing with mental illness. We put very little effort into focusing on where we want to go, on mental well-being and what that might mean. And just in doing that, I think we change the effectiveness of our policies. And that's where the work that's going on in Scotland is so very exciting, because that actually happened at government level and really did get embraced in the last two or three years. So anybody who wants to read more about this, I do thoroughly recommend Bruce Lipton's Biology of Belief. It is an extraordinary read. He was a cell biologist, and he takes this from the level of cell, right through the organism, right through to communities, and why it is important to focus on the positive.